Hello everybody, Dazis here. Today I would like to make a retrospective video. When 2020 happened, a lot of people look what's changed in the past decade and variety of the subject, which make me think naturally about what's happened in past 10 years in the winter cooling hobby area. And after thinking about it on a few days, I realized for me personally, the main change in past 10 years is a reverse of the trend for the function over the form. For this particular hobby we all are in. And right now, most people concerned about how things look rather than how they perform. That's how I feel from the all the question and interaction with customers I get on the store. And I still think there is this number of people who interested in the performance of the system, how to create systems that performs better. And for those people, I would like to review old tips and tricks that are still applicable today. So how I define high performance water cooling system? This is a system that has the lowest possible delta between your room temperature around you, where the computer sits, and your coolant temperature. So basically you take heat from your components, try to expel it, and the closer you get to the room temperature is a better system perform. To achieve that, you need to do a few things. First of all, you need to maximize performance of your heat exchangers, which is your radiators and fan assembly. You also need to use the best possible, most effective cold plates, which is more commonly known as like water blocks, CPU, GPU, whatever other components you're cooling, like memory. You also try to minimize restriction for your liquid and maximize your flow, so the heat from your components taken away as fast as possible. And also, the last, which is often forgotten but important thing, is you try to minimize all additional heat sources that can fight you back. So another thing that important to keep in mind, that the fight, your journey for this minimizing your delta, is very easy in the beginning. So you get multiple degrees improvement by putting bigger radiators or faster fans, but the closer you get to room temperature, the more difficult it becomes. And a certain point, you be flattened out. Doesn't matter what you do, you basically reach the maximum that you can do with additional components, and it makes no point to proceed any further. That actually allows you to a little bit overdo things on one side and maybe slacking on the other side, which actually makes things easier because that allows you to be a little bit more flexible on how your system looks and so on and so forth. So I would like to break the whole conversation and a few separate components, if you will, and see what the best techniques can be used in order to maximize your cooling performance. I would like to start from selection of a computer cases. Things changed dramatically since 10 years ago. Now the variety of the cases is staggering. They're all ready to go to be water cooled and can accept any kind of water cooling components. They have a bunch of holes, bunch of mounting elements that allows you to put everything easily. In the past, we had to cut meshes in order to allow air go inside of the case easily, or even to cut entire panels in order to put radiators, because nobody even assumes that you put anything inside, such as water cooling radiators. But fundamentals actually didn't change. The fundamental here is the best way to achieve the maximum cooling performance out of your system, to give it easiest access to the fresh air from your room, to your fan and radiator assembly. And from that perspective, your absolutely easiest way and the best bet to use totally open frame cases, such as a Thermatec P3, P5, P7 type of case. That basically is the absolutely best result for your cooling performance, because nothing abstract excess air to your radiator and you get the maximum possible output out of it. If that's not the case and you don't want to have open type of frame case for your system, you also still can use old tricks when you essentially don't use side panel at all. So you build your system in normal tower case and put everything inside in traditional way, but you can take panel out, and in the past you can get as much as like 5-7 degrees from just removing the side panel. So sometimes it's worse. It costs you almost nothing to achieve, and it's actually a good way to maximize your cooling performance of your system. My second category is the heat exchangers. Not many changed since 10 years ago. We still have only two types of radiators. It's either round tubes that in most cases connected in a serialized manner, or you have flat tubes radiators. When you have a flat tube that in most cases is just parallel flow, it's either U-shaped form or just one time across if you have a cross flow type of the model. The trickery remains exactly the same as 10 years ago. In order to maximize the output of your radiator, you need to try to maximize the length as your priority number one. The second priority is the thickness of radiator, as final priority is your width. So if you can choose, go in that order and you can get the maximum performance from that perspective. Second thing that I would like to mention is 10 years ago, when people was milking every single fraction of degree, there was a lot of talks about what's the best possible combination between the speed of the fan and the density of your fins, or also if they're beneficial to put extra layer of the fans and put fans on both sides, or which like this side or this side fan need to be placed. I did a multiple tests. You're welcome to go back a few years and watch all of them. And in my perspective, in my opinion, it falls more under hair splitting type of category. There are so many ways to achieve high performance gains for your system rather than all these little tricks and like trying to figure out which combination is the best. So I would say that it's not even worth going that route anymore. In terms of the fan specifically, still few things stands as before, and the best choice for radiators is the fans which has a specific blade design or impeller design. The two best fans still is a Noctua and Gentle Typhoon. You can see the both has a turbine type of the blades. They create high pressure, which allows you to push air better through the mesh, which is a restrictive type of thing. And if you try to use the fans that designed for the computer cases, your result will be not as good. And typically, you can see the blades is totally have a different shape for those type of the models. Another thing that not applicable any longer, but it was kind of interesting, I would like to pay a little tribute to that. Right now, we're almost everybody standardized on the size of the fan, which is 25 millimeter in thickness. In the past, it was very popular to use 38 millimeter fans, and at some point, we even have a model from TFC that have a 55 millimeter thickness. So the blades is much bigger, they shovel larger now amount of air, so at the same speed they push larger volume, which create a lot of the thickness. In today's, you still can go that route and it will be still nice result with that, but one thing you need to remember that most of the 38 millimeter fans available at this point in the market, the industrial type of models, they're very durable, but the ball bearing and essentially very noisy, because when you use it in some telecommunication server environment, nobody really cares about noise levels. So if you're using your system, you will have to deal with a very noisy type of device. So not everybody wants to do that, and maybe there's other ways you would like to proceed, but it's still a valuable option and not very expensive in order to put really potent fans on your radiator and get those temperatures go down. Pretty cool. After fans, my fourth category would be water blocks or cold plates. Well, things changed dramatically since 10 years in terms of everybody standardized on the same design. For the CPU blocks specifically, and now for GPU blocks as well, since introduction of impingement plate in the middle that create focused pressurized flow of liquid through the fins in the center of the block, there was no advances whatsoever, and everybody essentially adopted this particular design for both CPU and a couple of years ago for GPUs as well. So in that sense, selecting better performance blocks became fruitless exercise in my opinion, because essentially you have the same device. What you're looking here is probably more looking for quality materials and to see if manufacturers cut any corners. Because, for example, for GPUs, you can have a partially covered block like this EK model that I have right here. So we have a cold plate, only covered portion
of the GPU, and I don't have an open one, but this is a the same generation of water block from Beats Power. You can see that you can see the metal goes all the way around. So essentially, you have a cold plate that goes a full length of the water block. We even had old days we had this terminology that's called full cover block or not full cover block. So full cover block, I still think that is the best choice. And like Beats Power or Water Cool, they're still doing the blocks that fully covered, and that usually my personal selection for this kind of devices. The next on the list is the tubing. It doesn't matter what you use, soft tubes or hard tubes. The only function of the tubing to transport liquid between your components. And for that, you need to consider only two things. One is the size of the tube. Essentially, what you want to have is diameter of the tube as close as possible to the port on each of your devices. So, and it's actually not the quarter G port, it's actually inner diameter of the fitting that attached to that port. The bigger diameter it is, the better, but tube better to match that diameter as best as possible. If you use the bigger tubes, you think you will have a better result, but in fact, you actually create the additional turbulence that happen when you're going from the smaller diameter to the larger diameter, and doesn't actually a good thing. And the small tube naturally will limit your flow rate. So if you have something that very similar in diameter between the component and the tubing, that's the most efficient system that flows just most easiest way. Second thing that important to remember is actually not the tube itself, but how you lay the tube. The most efficient system will be the system with the shortest runs. You just connect everything the shortest possible way, so you have a minimum drag of the liquid inside of the tubing. So create all these spiral fancy things that sometimes people like to promote, or go like really around the case for the visual reasons, only creates additional drag and additional restriction in your system, and that basically hurts your performance. So if you're milking every single fraction of degree, just go as straight as possible. That's as simple as that. As long as we're talking flow rate, it's good moment to touch up on the pumps. People still, as 10 years ago, mostly use the two models DDC or D5 pumps from the Lange, or the equivalents rebranded by other companies. Basically, it's still the same thing. Difference between DDC and D5 from the performance perspective is not very much, so it doesn't matter what you use. Mostly people select from between one or other because of the noise and foam factor. But in terms of the temperatures, you probably get the same result from both. What's matter is still the flow rate. I saw some people saying that doesn't matter, but it's not entirely true. If you don't have a totally overkill system when everything else just already plateaued, higher flow rate will result lower temperature because you remove the heat faster from your components. I did a test almost 10 years ago on very old i7-920, I think, and I observed as much as 1 degree per each 1 liter per minute. So from 1 to 5 speed on D5, I was dropping 1 liter every step, and I get 1 degree high temperatures. And when you go deep below 1 liter per minute, they actually you get a big drop in temperatures, and that's the reason why all-in-one systems never can outperform the custom loop, because there is very little pumps inside of the CPU block that sits on your CPU. And all-in-one systems, they always lower than 1 liter per minute, so they actually suffering and struggling to keep temperatures down. When you have a luxury of the custom loop, you can go a lot a gallon per minute. So it's important to have good flow rate, and it's also it can be beneficial if you use dual pump system, because essentially you put second pump and you double your flow rate and you get a few degrees out of it. It's also the cheapest option to have a second pump, but it also give a little bit peace of mind in terms of reliability. Again, not related to performance, but something that I personally like to do. My number 7 would be fittings. We already touched a little bit on what's important about fittings. Essentially, the bigger inner diameter of the fitting is more beneficial for you. And not all fittings are equal. For example, I put just randomly 2 3858 fitting. One is from XSPC and other one from EK.
And you can even visually can see that XSPC is much smaller in the diameter versus EK. And when I measure it, I got 8.8 millimeters on the diameter on EK and 8.3 millimeters diameter on XSPC. So essentially, if you use EK, you have a little bit better flow and essentially a little bit lower temperatures, whatever it gives you. So it's important when you select your fittings, try to see the one that has a big diameter. Sometimes the manufacturer actually even refer to them as a high flow fittings. So basically they have a thinner wall of the fitting that allows you to make larger inner diameter, but it's a little bit more tricky to manufacture because you need to drill hole more carefully. Second thing is that sometimes you can see the diameter not even equal inside of the fittings, and you can have one side is a bigger diameter, another side a small diameter, so you have a little step inside of the diameter change inside of the fitting. It's not a good thing either, because that's also reduce your flow and also create additional turbulence that also makes things harder for pump to push through. Another thing is that some fitting can perfect round inner surface, and the other fitting might have a provision for the tool, so it makes the inner surface not round, and that also creates some additional turbulence inside of the system. So essentially you want as smooth flow as possible, and for that reason round and big is better than uneven shape and the smaller. On that note, also many 10 years ago or whatever 5 years ago was a lot of debates regarding the sharp 90 degree turns. They do have some impact, and I actually did a test when I had a bunch of 90 degrees fittings and keep adding them and changing the flow rate, and what I found out, I was getting 0.1 liter per minute drop with every 90 degree fitting that I'm using. So if you use a bunch of them, so all these fractions of the flow rate will add up together, and you can lose, I don't know, it would be a full degree, but you can lose a little bit. So if you want just to mill the maximum performance, doesn't matter what, because you just want it, I would recommend to use a more smoother turning fittings, such as like this 90 degree, you see it's like two 45 ones together, so it's make like a round turn for the liquid. If you have fitting 90 degree like this, so basically just drill hole this way, the hole drill hole this way, and you have a something like inside which just look like two drills that cross each other. This creates a lot of turbulence and things like this, and that's why it makes flow a little bit slower. It's also more beneficial if you use a hard tubing, that probably to bend tube itself make nice smooth run, then they use two fittings and connect them together with two fittings. Sometimes no choice, but one or other is more beneficial, and we're speaking about strictly about trying to milk as much performance as possible. So that would be my recommendation. Winding down to number 8 is the reservoirs, and I will be a little bit brief here. I just say that in my opinion, the best option would be steel tube reservoir, and even better to have a pump attached to it, because that reduces one of the connections that you need to run between pump and reservoir, let's say. And that will be the best bet as I see it. I never test it also, so just take it with a grain of salt. But I would like to mention that in the past couple years, we have a huge rise of the distribution plates, which essentially replacing reservoir function in many cases, and have even sometimes pump attached to it. But keep in mind, back to the previous topic we just discussed, that what is a distribution plate is just two pieces of plastic that connected together with a bunch of ports on it. So essentially it's a collection of a bunch of 90 degree fittings. So if we're talking about distribution plates that is probably can have like 10 ports versus using, let's say, tube reservoir which has a two ports. So you're talking about 290 degrees versus like 1090 degrees. So obviously distribution plate will create higher drag and reduce your flow rate a little bit comparing with the traditional tube reservoir. So that's as simple as that. Almost on the finish line, my number 9 is parasitic heat sources. In the recent years, RGB lights became basically mandatory part for any water cooling components you can think of. But they're not very good for performance.
And let me explain why. Essentially, every little LED chip is a small source of the heat. If it's we have a good quality LED, it's usually around about 40-45 degrees. Lower quality LEDs can run as hot as 70 degrees, and you have hundreds of them in your system, and they all keep heating up and fighting all your cooling efforts on the opposite direction. More than that, some of the LED solutions actually even worse because they very close to the liquid itself, like inside of the reservoirs or inside of the CPU blocks, when actually LED also trapped, so there's no ventilation, so they're basically cooking themselves, and they're also burning the liquid inside as well. So essentially, you try to cool your system, but you put a ring or square, if it's CPU block, inside of your system, and you're warming it up. Like, why? Because you like lights, I understand. But if you're after performance, the best solution for you, no lights, period. Maybe some inside of your case, but no inside of the water cooling component. The worst offenders, as I said, that the ones that close to the liquid itself. So inside of CPU blocks and inside of the reservoirs, it's really bad type of decision. Sometimes for the water cooling blocks, you have a big massive cover and maybe strip attached on the side, and it's like 1 inch or like 2 centimeters of plastic between the LED and liquid itself, then probably plastic will insulate and doesn't create much of the heat, at least for the liquid itself. It will still heat your case, but it maybe can mitigate it with the fans. But again, all this massive amount of LEDs is basically killing your system performance. And if you don't want it, just skip on it and save hundreds of dollars, which is beneficial as well. And my part 10 would be a conclusion and a reminder about something I was talking about 10 minutes ago or 15 minutes ago. Your journey for the best possible delta is very easy in the beginning and getting harder the further you proceed. So that actually create a little bit flexibility between the points that we were talking about. For example, you might put a massive amount of radiators and already max everything. So it doesn't matter what else you do. It doesn't basically gain you any additional flow rate, nothing like this. But this also allows you to cheat on certain things that not good for performance, but can be offset by the good techniques. So you might have a lot of radiators and that will compensate for additional lights you have, or for a bunch of 90 degrees because you want to have because it looks good. So that's knowledge where you get to the plateau level and what you can do to offset and balance things out. It only comes through your personal experimentation that you need to do from time to time, and also comes from your experience. And when you build a few systems, you kind of get a little bit feeling. So in that department, it's hard to make a tutorial and tell you how to do it. So every system is different, and that's something that you sometimes need to tweak a little bit on your own. But I hope this video was interesting for those who are still interested in performance systems, and for those who just want to remind what or remember how we did things a while ago, because all we care now is the rainbow waves, right? That's all. See you soon, guys.